You're listening to the SWN podcast.
And this is SWN.
Welcome to SWN.
Skull! Skull! Skull!
This is SWN.
And this is the Scottish Wrestling Network.
Where Scottish wrestling lives, I guess. Is that a tagline? I guess. I don't know.
Hello and welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy. Very professional beginning for a probably, possibly unprofessional show. On this edition, I am joined by the, some say the other half, some say the better half, some just say one half of Not Safe for Mums. We've had Patrick Petersky on, of course, the current Day of Birth Bonanza champion. Spoilers for anyone who hasn't watched it already. You should. It's a hilarious episode. It just gets, and Patrick is still bitter. Even though he won, he's still bitter about some of the questions that Grant McIver posed to the team. Like, I've done the intro yet, calm down. On this particular episode, I am joined by Kairn Douglas, one half of the hosting team of Fair City Wrestling podcast as well. Welcome to the show.
Now you can Thanks speak. For having me. Thank you. Thanks for having me. I can understand Patrick's bitterness though with that quiz, so we can maybe get into that later on.
I think it's just how it's worded. I think if we say this, it's a single WrestleMania, so I think it's a one day WrestleMania. I think, yeah, there's ways you can interpret the question. It doesn't matter. He won anyway.
He won.
So you know, if he lost by one point, I could see where he could indict a tribunal or have an investigation into the question. Mm-hmm. Thing. But he won it, so you know.
Yeah.
Suck up, Patrick.
Yeah.
Anyway,
I don't think Tom should be getting any more extra bonus 3 points.
Well, he still got the wooden spoon because he was still technically last. I just felt bad for Brody that she was last equal with Tom.
I don't count them 3 points, so Tom is still last in my books.
Well, yeah, that's why he got the booby prize. I spent a lot of time writing SWN on it. It actually took longer to get the sticker on it. That was an absolute pain in the arse to do. Anyway, this is about you. This is Kairn Douglas' episode of the SWN podcast. So we've got to start with the most boring question in wrestling podcasting, which is the icebreaker, the cliche. How did you get into wrestling? What made you a fan of pro wrestling?
Well, I used to watch wrestling when I was really young. I remember Kurt Angle with hair. That's how far back I go. And then, so I watched quite a bit of the Attitude Era, and then I fell away, just getting a bit older. Pals didn't really watch it, and I fell away for quite a few years. And then there was a couple of friends from school that were still into wrestling, and they invited us out to watch WrestleMania, and it was WrestleMania 30. So it was Daniel Bryan, it was that whole storyline for that WrestleMania that got me hooked right back in, and that's when I started following wrestling again and getting into it and watching it. And it was a couple of years really after that, so I was still watching it and getting more into it. And then after a few years, I started looking for training, and that's kind of how I got into it. Just kind of a passion just kind of grew, and getting back into it, it reminded me of the feeling I had watching it when I was away and as well. So it's all that mumble jumbo.
I've just watched the video there. Jesus has not entered this room. The sun has just come back from behind a cloud and it's just hit my face like mad.
An epiphany.
Yeah, it's like you mentioned WrestleMania 30 and then the clouds parted. Was that the last time there was a single WrestleMania? Anyway,
No.
So you got to Attitude Era. I never had this break. I wasn't one of those cool people that fell away from wrestling. How did what did you replace it with? What was the kind of new cool thing people liked?
There was quite a lot. I got right into playing games was one thing. I also played rugby. I've done different martial arts as well growing up. So I did enjoy, I'd done MMA for a while. I enjoyed that. The training aspect. is what I enjoyed more of that. I wasn't really more into the competitions. And then I kind of fell away again from that. And then when I started training at wrestling, I just it, I don't know, there was something about it that just I fell in love. It's made me want to go to the gym more. It makes me want to work out. I just love it.
I think that's interesting. So you took away the performance sport aspect of things, right? And you fell with wrestling and went into other things, but you still kept the like combat nature in your life with the rugby and MMA and all that kind of stuff. Interesting that the training bit was more exciting than the actual doing bit, which I suppose that leads into wrestling, because generally, I don't want to spoil it for people, you're generally not supposed to hurt each other when you're wrestling. It's more like a bit of sparring, bit of performance art kind of thing at the same time. So it's interesting that that's always still been a through line through your life, whether it's been actual wrestling or other sports and things like that. So growing up, you mentioned Kurt Angle as being, well, you mentioned him as having hair, and that was a long time ago. That was pre-2002, for those that are keeping a score at home. Was there anyone else that you recognized, your favorites that you remember from when you started watching?
I mean, since going back and rewatching, I'm a big Owen Hart fan. I'm a big fan of Owen Hart. I quite like a lot of his work, the style he went with. Trying to think from my childhood. Obviously, big ones like Rock, Stone Cold, just kind of a given for being so young as well, watching it at the time. And then, as I say, coming back into it, Bryan Danielson, that's my boy. That's who got me right back into wrestling. I think the height status as well, because I'm not as tall as Patrick and things. I'm more on the same height size as Daniel Bryan. And seeing the accomplishments, of him getting there and doing it was a wee bit of motivation and inspiration. And that's that. So he that's why I'm quite a big fan of his as well.
There's like when you're growing up, you mentioned those being the obvious ones. You gotta have a boy. There's gotta be a couple that are like, you shouldn't like these guys kind of things. Like, I mean, you can't really speak about them nowadays, but Val Venis was one of my favorites growing up. Just something so bizarre, and well, my first WrestleMania was WrestleMania 15. That's how old I am. So you've Ken Shamrock and all that kind of stuff. So it's Go on. Who's your cringe one? You mentioned the cool ones. Who's the one that you're like, oh my God, there's Prince Albert.
Yeah, I don't know. Can you say like I was a big Chris Benoit fan.
There we go. Val Venis to Chris Benoit, the first 5 minutes. There we go.
I don't know if you can still bring it.
Think it's contextual now. I think if you go, oh, it's 2024, I love Benoit now, that's probably a bit more of a
I mean, he's in-ring ability was just something else at the time. Like just purely rating him as a wrestler and not like trying not to, But
So
yeah, so
it's
that
personal life. You could set aside that for a moment. Yeah, the
if I
performance
was
artist
thinking
thing.
as a wrestler, he was yeah.
Benoit.
So don't you want to be asked that one into
You know what? No, I'll say this for Benoit. This is gonna be, that's a terrible start to a sentence. I'll say this for Benoit. His gear always looked so cool.
Yeah.
Like,
It
even
was like
back when
simple, but it really stood out.
when he debuted in WWF anyway, when he had this like the black with the red ovals, the white outline. I remember that action figure, and it was like the coolest figure to look at. It was just ace.
He had the black one with the yellow, and it was like stripes, like claw marks, but they were like this
Yeah,
simple. That was a
I
really
like the
good one as
yellow one.
well.
Is the yellow? Here we are. Speak. This is going to be a very long segment. We speak about Chris Benoit. But no, the yellow gear as well with the claw mark. The claw marks, which is cool. But I didn't like so much when he had the four reel stuff. I thought that was a bit cringy. But that was a little bit. Now we know. I was a bit more of a art imitating life. Let's move on from Chris Benoit. Right. So, starting training then. So we mentioned off record that you started at another place. Those that may be able to find the clues in amongst the episode will know where, but for now we just know another place. So when did you find out about the school? When did you think, okay, right, I'm gonna give this a go?
So I'm sure it came up on Facebook. I'm sure that's what it was, and it was like a 4 week trial. Come try it out, see how you get on, and then you would continued after that. So that's what I went and done. And as I said, I just I just fell in love with it after like the first bump. I was genuinely like, this is something different. So yeah, it was just, it's hard to explain. I think everyone that's into it understands like what I'm saying. It's just a different like moment of like, this is fun, and a different way of like, yeah, you're knocking your pan in, doing your cardio and all that, but it's worth it. It's, well, for me, it was anyway. So I done that, and I was there after about a year and a half, and then COVID happened, and then there was some obviously during COVID and all that. So after COVID, I was training down at Respect for a while, and it was just looking sharp that was doing the coaching there for a while. So I was there for about a year as well, and then I got a job through, because obviously I'm originally from the West Coast, so I then got a job through over in Dundee, and so then I had to move through here, and then that's how I ended up starting training at FCW.
I mean that's a fair journey of places to go from. When you mentioned like just knowing, I think that seems to be the kind of overall story I'm getting from people is once you do that first bump, you know or you don't if you're gonna keep doing it. I don't know if it's because we mentioned that you've quite physical, like extracurricular activities with the rugby and MMA and all that kind of stuff. I don't know whether wrestling appealed to your body because you had control of kind of what you were doing. Like, when you're falling, you're doing the falling stuff. And I suppose I don't know if that's would be any correlation to
Yeah, well, because I remember when
things.
getting taught them, and then it was like remembering back to like doing karate and Muay Thai and being like, oh, these are it's like break falls. And it was like things like that, and being able to then so like take things from like blocking and then using it to get into a move within wrestling as well. It's things like that I quite like being quite technical, so I like bringing that aspect in as well.
So coming back to wrestling after COVID, you did Respect, which I mean I think anytime anyone brings up Looking Sharp, I go on a little bit of a love fest because I think Looking Sharp's just the best, one of the best in the country. So was Respect just because it was most accessible to you at the time, or was there anything was Lou a guy that you went, oh, he's here, I'll go there? What was there any
So, yeah, a
particular?
bit of both. It was probably the closest place from where I was living at the time. Lou obviously done a bit of training where I was before. So I'd already trained under him as well. So when I found out he was there, it was more, as you said, reason to go there as well. And then a friend from school, Sean Moran, you think you know as well. And Sean was going down and he was telling me as well. So I ended up that so it was a kind of an amalgamation of all that is why I ended up going down there as well. And Robbie Cardwell, who I started training with around about the same time, he was down there. So I knew quite a few people that were going down after COVID that were starting to train there. But I didn't feel that I was going completely somewhere new.
It was a weird time coming out of COVID because of all the stuff that came out that a lot of people were looking for new places and looking for new ground to go on for whatever reason. Some just decided not to come back or at least are have taken their a long time to test the waters. Was there ever a thought once all that stuff happened that you were done, or were you always just trying to keep a lookout for like a Respect? You mentioned that a couple of people you knew were there anyway, but was the dream dead at any point, or were you always was always there?
Feel like kind of COVID helped the dream at first, to be fair, because I was freshly in and I was getting close to making some sort of debut. I was getting close to that goal, then COVID happened. So COVID kind of already killed it. And then there was just so much time and in COVID that I think I would word it. But yeah, like it died right away, but then having that amount of period of time, it started to come back when you knew there was other places to go train and things were opening back up again. So it was weird. It was weird because it was like a wee like roller coaster of like, oh, it's done. Or maybe we can something that I've done with it. Oh, so
I'm just going to pause briefly for a moment. I'll still going to keep recording. Everyone's going to get a good look at my gut because I need to put that blind down because I cannot see a thing. I
You look
cannot
like
see a
you're
thing
on
now.
fire.
I'm white enough as it is.
I'm sure it's great for everyone to see my my frame. I can see. Thank God. Right. That's what you look like. Okay, cool. Right. I'll let my eyes adjust. Anyway, right. So, Fair City Wrestling then. So we moved to Dundee. Don't know what, what you did in life to have to move to Dundee, but yeah, Fair City. So when you went there, these relatively new company, they started just before the pandemic. When going in there's a lot of, there would have been a lot of people that were doing the same as yourself. They're looking for a new place to go. I'm guessing likes of again familiar faces like your Tom Atlas would have been there already. Was there again people that you knew at that school already?
So, obviously, when I knew I was having to move through, I was still training at Respect. So, I was talking to Lou King Sharp about it, and it was him that told me to get in contact with FCW to look at training under them. So, I had Chrissy telling me that's where to go. And then I did know Tom from the previous place as well. I met him a couple of times. I already had him on Facebook. So, when I knew he was there, I started messaging him as well about coming through. And Tom was quite welcoming as well for like, so to be like, well, at least I know someone. But I mean that was really it. I didn't really know many anyone else. When I went through, but I have to say, like they were all very welcoming, all very friendly, and they're very a good knit of people. I'm quite happy to have went through and started training there.
How familiar were you with the Scottish scene before you started your first batch of training? Was the Facebook message, Facebook thing, the first thing you saw about Scottish wrestling, or were you aware of it
I
in
was
your head?
aware, but I wasn't as like big. I didn't know as much about it as some people probably would have. I was quite very, what's the word? Not dormant, but
Naive? No.
yeah,
Yeah.
well, yeah, you could say so. I wasn't that sure of what was going on, and it wasn't until I actually started training that I started taking more interest in the Scottish scene and started looking and watching old footage of things that was going on in that as well.
And like visiting cool websites like at the time OSWTV.wordpress.com, cool places just to get you caught up. So Fair City Wrestling, you're there, new place, new experiences. Did you find that when you enter these new places, or to Respect as well, Respect a little bit different because it's Lou that was there, but your training, did you feel like you went in having to try and relearn things again, or were they quite good at just kind of just adapting what you already learned into what they could teach kind of thing?
A bit of both. So there was probably maybe habits that I'd learned from certain places that I was then taught to not do. So there was some relearning and there was some adaptability. So it was a bit of both. It took me a time to really get myself like pushing myself at training consistently. Because now that I moved through here and how close training was, I could finally go quite consistent with it. And that's what I'd done for about, I think, a good year before I got out and got an actual debut.
What was the worst thing that you had to try and like unlearn to relearn? Is there anything particular that pops to mind that was just irritating that just never took forever to come out your brain?
No, not. I can't really, nothing specifically that I had to relearn, but I haven't redoing my front bumps because after not doing it and then building that for yourself at the ground again, that took a wee bit to kind of get back into. So that's probably when it sticks more in my head.
Oh, I thought it was gonna be something like saying "Come on, guys!" every time you try and fight back,
Well, you what the coming out and just clapping right away, clapping right away. That's one.
I've seen like not disparaging that school for that reason, but yeah, that's it. I've seen. I remember. I think it was a Stone Malone video of the ribbed him by making him do his entrance, to no crowd, and it's quite possibly the funniest slash saddest video I ever watched of a wrestler coming out to nobody going,
Come on, guys. It's like, oh no, this is what Thunderdome's gonna feel like.
Yeah.
Like we never knew at
What
the
a team
time.
that was. Yeah.
Were you? Did you enter the Thunderdome?
No, I mean, I think I signed up once, but I didn't get into it. No Spike, I think, I'm pretty sure Spike Tierney got on at some
I
point.
think he did. I
Yeah.
remember most of it. I got on like every month. I didn't pay for my network subscription for like a year, because I just
Yeah.
got into the I got into the Thunderdome every month. I was
No,
like, oh,
yeah.
yes, best time. I mean, horrible time, pandemic and everything like that. But I saved £10. I saved £10 a month, and you got
Yeah,
to.
any saving was good at that time.
I know I got more money to buy pops. That seems to be
Yeah.
what I did with my extra money, was
Yeah.
this wall of massive plastic. Oh, I didn't tell you before. We're allowed to swear on this podcast. I'm not
Oh,
monetized,
okay. Right.
so if they do slip out, don't worry about it. I'm not going
Yeah.
to edit it, unless you start going on to some sort of slanderous, like rant that I'm going to have to cancel.
Or being like or being like Tom Humphries and think you can just start dropping the C word anytime because he's now been told he's got free range.
Oh, big, hi.
Yeah.
Tom likes a C word. I didn't realize that until I gave him that
Only
free
when he's been
range.
given free range. Just
Now, next time I see him, whenever I come down next to a Fair City show, he'll be shouting just the C word at me while he's hitting me with that wooden spoon that I sent
you just
him.
give him a list of words that he can say and he'll just stick by them.
I'll probably shorter list would be the ones he can't.
Yeah.
So you started training. You said that's a year then between you starting again, starting at Fair City and getting your debut. Is that right?
Well, so obviously I got on some galas and things and some rumbles. And then it was building up. And then unfortunately it was like last. How long have I been through here now? So it'll be, yeah, it would have been about a few months, and then I was on a couple of galas where I was getting like some exposure and some training. And then it was the first Ardler show, was like maybe like the proper show in the Rumble. And I was down at and I was reffing some matches for them as well to obviously get more crowd exposure and things. And then it was last August, was it August? August, September. I ended up in hospital due to like, a dog attack. So that was a big injury that set me back for months as well. So I was meant to be in the Fair City Rumble last year. That happened. So then that was a good few months I was taken out as well. So that was that.
That seems like the most unlucky situation ever.
Yeah.
Because yeah, cause my notes have got decon, and then a match in July, I think it was, as well. So when was Fair City Rumbles after that, wasn't it?
Oh yeah, there was decon last year. Yeah, that was probably my first singles match with Ewan. I think that was last year. Is that right? And then it would have been, and I
Tayport.
think it was a Rumble in Perth the November just before that. So that would have been 22. What year were we in?
We're 24.
24. Yeah. So yeah.
Right. I've got 23 because probably you may not have been Kairn Douglas during that rumble. And that's what, yes, that's okay. Okay, cool.
Yeah. No, it may have been, but then I it was still it was like the truth. Was it in Deacon? Okay, the Deacon was the cosplay rumble.
Yes, that would be. Right.
So I was Bane, I think. Yeah. But I did have a singles match with Ewan at Deacon last year as well.
So I don't know how much we want to speak about the dog attack. If you're in hospital, probably not a lot. But how did you feel going back into training after that? I don't know like where things would have happened, but did it make you tentative about doing certain things again because of the things you would have had to go through to recover from that?
Yeah, so it was more kind of like, oh, my cardio is going to be right down because I've not been able to properly walk for a while, or like go out runs or do anything like that. And then when I come back, is the scar, is the stitching going to hold up? When can I come back? So even though then I was like fully healed, I still had more time to like kind of assess and kind of and to build myself back up to it again. But I was more motivated than when COVID, the stuff with COVID, because of how close I was getting ready, there was things set to go, and then that was just an unfortunate setback. So I was just more determined to get myself ready when I came back.
So let's talk about when you come back then. The proper, your I would say your proper debut then. We'll go with that. First main show. What have I got noted here? So I've got March 2024 was your first city wrestling debut, which oh, was this year.
Yes,
God,
that was this year.
the years have merged so much. How leave it to this March 2024. So what's that? Now when we're in August when this episode comes out, and not in July when we're recording it. That's 5 months. 5 months. So you went from possibly again reassessing whether you're going to come back to wrestling to then making your debut for the company that you train at to then being in a tag title match. That is a lot to pack in 5 months to for it. When you made your debut, did you feel like that was would that was that enough at that point for you? If it didn't go any further from that point, would you have been okay with that, or was it just when you did it, you're like, that's it. That's what I'm doing now for as long as I possibly can.
It felt like the start of the train leaving, like it's starting to go, things are starting to take off, like we're starting to go somewhere with it. But for a while, obviously, with the back and forth with different training places, having to move for work, like all that COVID thing, it felt a bit like limbo. It felt like, am I ever going to be able to experience what I've got into this to experience? And then when it finally happened, I was like, yes, this has been worth all this pain and heartache trying to get here, and let's keep going. That's my takeaway from it right now.
So, how did the relationship with Patrick Patierski begin?
So you started.
That sounds like a really saucy question when
Yeah.
way I worded that.
He started a few months, maybe about 6 months after I'd started at FCW, and we just clicked. We just got on really well with training, and a friendship blossomed. And then next thing we knew, we had tag team ideas. We were like, "Oh, we could do this," and we've got ideas for promos and things. And we were like, "We have to make this official. We have to become a team." So then that's it. It wasn't. We weren't put together by anyone, or it wasn't like we used to. It just naturally became. And if he's good, I trust the boy. Trust him.
So who kind of brought the name Not Safe for Mums forward? I can't remember if I spoke to this with Patrick. I don't know if we spoke to Patrick just before Not Safe for Mums became a thing. But anyway, yeah, your side of things anyway.
I think it was me that pitched the idea jokingly, and then again we just spitball ideas at each other. We'll start making funny logo ideas, and it just kind of grew from there. But I think it was me. I think I just went NSFM, and then he's like, "What's the M for?" And I went, "I don't know, bums." And I think that's where it kind of blossomed from, because like we can make this something.
It's like that thing. I'm seeing the meme recently, and it makes me laugh. The guys can spend an hour at a pub just naming obscure footballers. Is that kind of energy that you and Patrick have, where you have a group chat going, and you could just sit there and just go, JJ Okocha, or just like a wrestling version of it, just going, oh, what about this? And then he goes,
Yeah,
what about this kind of thing, and that's it.
pretty much. Yeah, it's pretty much like we're always kind of thinking on the same wavelength, or one of us will have an idea, and then we'll bounce it off the other one, and we'll be able to make it better because we just gel so well together. We just work so well.
Now, the last month-ish of stuff in your Fair City Wrestling journey has been a bit wild.
Yes.
So we'll try and deconstruct as much as we can. So we've got the Red Gate stuff first of all, and I think this is where we really got to see more of Kairn Douglas as a character, especially on social media, because you had the hunt for Patrick Patierski and the. I almost, until you sent me the picture we used for the graphic, I almost used the picture of you with the looking the wanted poster, because it was just your face in it is just hilarious to me. It's a great expressive face. So you had that. Do you have any nerves putting yourself out more for doing things like that? Was there anything that held you back from being a bit, being a larger than life character as wrestlers are.
It was definitely difficult. The very first promo I done, it took me a while recording and things, and I was like, oh, I don't like it. But I found the more consistent I am and I'm doing it, the more better. I may not be getting better. I feel like I'm getting better, but I feel better in myself doing it. I don't feel as embarrassed or as awkward. The same with when I started doing the podcast with Patrick as well. I was a bit, oh, and it took me a couple before I got my footing with it. And as I say, Patrick's been quite helpful as well with the ideas and things, so we can bounce ideas off to make it and make it funnier, make it more larger than life, and add that kind of humour to it as well. Because at the end, you're just trying to entertain people. That's the joy and the fun of it as well.
I mean, it's, I can attest for the things like podcasting, trying to sound natural. That's the worst bit, is trying to sound like you're not like thinking of questions. Like I tried to naturally bring up a question. I thought about 2 minutes after you brought up a point. I'm like thinking, I need to think of this question and listen to you at the same time. But I think the more I've learned in this, so many episodes I've done now, is as long as I've got some notes to fall back on, I'll just ramble. I'll eventually get to that question or a point that I'll get to. So you went from that nervous and everything, nervous and or anxious about being a bit more larger in life, to Tayport state of mind, which is possibly seen the, anyone who hasn't seen the video, go check out on Facebook and YouTube and what have you. It's a that's a bit of a sharp turn from having to re-record and being nervous about what you're going to say and trying to relax to then dancing in Tayport in front of, well, to be honest, I looked in the background. It wasn't that many people.
There
I don't
wasn't
think there's that many people.
that many people.
but
That
still. So how did that come about then? It's your partner, your other half that does the actual singing bit of it. Am I right in
did
thinking
help.
that? How did you rope her into it, first of all?
Just by asking. Come on, you know you want it. Come on, come on, and then so once she does it, she's quite. Well, that was pretty good, by the way. So, but yeah, so that's it was just kind of more constant asking to get her to join.
Is she a wrestling fan at all, or is she just along for the ride?
She never was, and then around about the time I was getting into watching it. I can't remember, there was a pay-per-view. I think it was the first women's ladders match, whatever pay-per-view that was on. It had like, it was like Becky Lynch, Charlotte Flair. They were on it. I'm sure it was a ladder match.
Is Money in the Bank, a Money in the Bank one, or?
I think so. I was sitting watching it and she came in and she was like, oh, and kind of got hooked and kind of watched. And from that moment, she was more interested in it. And she'll watch the pay-per-views and that with me as well. And she does. So she does enjoy it and she'll come and she enjoys the shows. So she's got hooked into it.
But yeah, so Tayport state of mind then. So she's you've asked nicely several times. There's a call log to prove it. But yeah, so how. How did you get the lyrics? How did you get the idea? Patrick put on his social media about Goldie looking chain, and all that kind of stuff. So I need to know everything. How this came about.
So Patrick came up with this idea. And he came to me with it, and at first I was like, "I'm not getting this." And this is what I'm saying about how we work well. I was like, "Pat, I'm not getting this." So he came over one day, and we was going over it again, and it was just one day, and he showed me what he was, where he got the idea from, the Goldie looking chain parody and everything, and then it clicked. So then he'd done rough draft of lyrics, and we went over it. So then we worked together and we changed things. And then I had the idea for filming and doing the different things. So it ended up, as Patrick, he came up with the idea and then it became a good collaborative thing. We worked together. He just, I think it's been a good thing. I think people have enjoyed it. I think they've had a good laugh watching it.
Was it just a coincidence that you both had Zubaz, or was that purchased specifically for the
I got Patrick into Zubas.
they look so comfy, and then I see the price tag and I'm like, oh, they've got to be like
They're very comfy.
they've got to
They're
cup all
very
the right
comfy.
things for me to spend that much on them.
They're
So
actually the I had I think I got them off the WWE store. So there was like one, it was like Eddie Guerrero one, Latino Heat, and then a Razor Ramon one. And then when we went to All In, Dan was like, Patrick was like, we should get Zubas. And I was like, well, let's. So the ones we got, the ones we were wearing, the other ones we wore to All In, because it was like, oh, we'll get All In colors.
God, you two are a right bunch of nerds, aren't you?
Yeah.
He says on our
Well,
wrestling podcast.
yeah, I know.
That's
Because
the
we
best
bought
way,
quite a
though.
bit behind them.
I know. That's why I say it ironically. I think if anyone,
Yeah.
if I said it and you took offense to it, I'd be like, look at this.
Yeah.
This is, you're one of us. It's
Yes.
fine. I bought belts. I
Brilliant.
never. The only thing I won is an eBay auction. That's what all I've won for them. So with that, this is going further ahead though. We had the podcast. We talked about it briefly for a moment there, the FCW podcast. So initially it was Patrick and actually it wasn't. Initially it was Duke and Nathan North, and then it became Duke and Patrick. And then due to developments outside of the podcast world, it became yourself and
Yeah.
Patrick. So you said you were a bit apprehensive. Yeah, what was how did How did Patrick approach you to go, right, I need a co-host. Do you want to do it?
Obviously, before the stuff that was going on with Duke at the time and outside, he was mentioning saying, look, I need some help. And at the same time, we were developing, becoming a tag team. So we thought, well, why not? It just gives us more time to be around each other as well. So we, just. And I was quite hesitant. I was like, oh, I don't know. And he was like, well, come on and we'll try one and we'll see how it goes. And it was just from there. And after the first couple, I kind of got my foot in with it. And I felt quite comfortable with it.
It's good fun.
Yeah, it's a
It's
good
just good
laugh.
fun.
Yeah.
I like it. I like it for like the FW podcast specifically because it's focused. You know, when I'm doing my podcast, this one anyway, I lose my own track really quickly, own train of thought. I mean, I'll end up in a tangent about Chris Benoit, for example. Whereas the FCW one, it's very much it's for the promotion, it's for all that kind of thing, and that's why I like about and you can tell that yourself and Patrick definitely have a little bit of a rapport. That word, yeah, we'll go rapport. As far as guests go, so your first one, am I right to think you weren't a co-host for your first one? You were a guest, and that was the hot chip challenge you did.
And that was the first one where Duke didn't show up, so it was just me and Patrick on it as well.
And then from going forward, you became a co-host. So. Of the episodes that you've done so far, I don't want to like put you on the spot to pick your favorite child here, but is there any particular episode that you've went, yeah, I'm good at podcasting. This has been a great episode, kind of thing.
It would probably be the one with Pretty Boy Sam and Hunter Redwood, because they were the two that during and after I was like, no, I thought I enjoyed that. I felt more confident in it. I felt I knew what I was doing compared to the previous ones. And then after that, everything's been going pretty smoothly. Well, apart from the last one where GD just showed up out of nowhere in Patrick's house.
Yeah, that was a bit of an odd one for listen. Still good fun though. So everyone go check out SW podcast because if you want to listen to a podcast on our network that hasn't got my voice on it,
Don't
perfect. Because
if mine's as much better, to be fair, but okay.
I mean, at this point, if anyone's listened to all near 300 episodes plus the auxiliary podcast like the WrestleZone one and the Disco one and all that kind of stuff, then they must be sick to the like. Their ears must be bleeding hearing whatever accent I have, because I don't know what it is. I know it's somewhere in the Northeast, I'm guessing, but no, it's like just something different for your ears. Go check out the FCW podcast at the very least. If any guests that you want to get on that you haven't had yet.
Oh, there's a few. We like to get Brody on, get Brody Adler on. That would be good. Get
You
the
dice dissect
FCW.
the Day of Birth Bonanza again. That's
Yes.
you, yeah.
Oh, maybe we could get her and Tom on and get them to debate each other. Oh.
You could do a quiz and then you could settle who actually was the loser in that.
Yes, the losers quiz.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I'll need to pitch that to Patrick.
I can see that going down well for Brody.
Yeah.
so yeah, so Brody's great. I've had Brody on a few times on this podcast, and she's just an absolute riot. So I absolutely would be tuning in for that. I mean, tune in for them anyway, because I've got to. I upload them and then I check them because I just trust you guys to not be weird.
I'll take a note of that.
I know, I feel really bad when I upload it, and then during I listen back to it, and I've uploaded it already, and Patrick goes like, "And Billy might have edited a bit in here." No, it's already uploaded. I haven't listened to it yet, and then I get to go, "Oh shit!" I think that's why the last one he did the video edit, because he's out to the point going, "Yeah, I'm going to put stuff in, and Billy's not going to do this, so I may as well do it myself." Cool, fair. You do less work for me. I don't mind. I get. So
He quite enjoys doing that.
It's yeah, it's like you're saying, you sound more comfortable with each passing episode as well. And mentioned like Brody, getting Brody on. We're still due a Dickie Divers episode, whether that'll ever happen, whether
We
he'll
need
arrive.
to rearrange that at some point as well.
It's just finding time now, isn't it? For I mean, for yourself, you guys do it on location, which is a little bit more difficult, I suppose, is trying to get all three is to be in a place.
I mean, we could easily start looking if we're starting to get people from over the West Coast or more central belt. We could look at start doing on teams as well. I've been saying we should maybe look at trying to start recording them as well and getting the video up of this as well and get that up.
Yeah, I mean, I like there's been a couple of them when we did the hot chip. When you, I say we, I have a no input on this. I just get told who's on the show, and I get sent the files. That is my input in the whole thing. But yeah, when the hot chip challenge, I love that there's a video of it, so I threw it in at the end as a post credit and all that kind of stuff. And I like that, just little different things. But no, it just how people consume them as well. I mean, our YouTube numbers are just in the pits for everything at the moment, but our audio numbers is amazing. So it's a case of how people are taking it in. And if folk want to see your lovely faces for an hour, 40 minutes, or whatever, then god damn it, you got to give people what they want. At the same time, there was no point to that sentence. I kind of just ran it out and then just got confused. I thought I would get to a point before running out of steam. Anyway, right, strap match, very much a left turn here. So you had a strap match. Seen the picture of your back afterwards, and you've mentioned that when you had your first bump, you knew it felt right and all that kind of stuff. How did a strap feel?
Pretty sore, to be honest. Yeah, it's pretty sore. But I did enjoy the match. I enjoyed what we put out. I'm quite happy with the result. I'm quite happy with the story it was leading with as well, with Redgate over the time. Got to defend my pal Patrick. I don't know where he was, but I did know where he was, and I was sending him away to get help, so I had to keep the fight going. But yeah, no, I enjoyed the strap match. It was different as well. It was a different style to work, so I quite like that.
Do you find, I mean, as an outsider looking in, knowing you got to sell and all that kind of stuff, you got to make it look expressive and all that kind of stuff, is it a lot easier in a strap match to do that?
Yeah.
Stupid
Because
question, obvious answer, but still.
when it hurts, if you're able to vocal that hurt out more, you can try and disperse all it quicker. That's what I found anyway.
Yeah, as the scream goes out, the strap hits again. So that was kind of your first proper big kind of program in Fair City Wrestling is with Redgate, and then you've pivoted really quickly into stuff with DE, with Duke and Sebastian Asher, Spike Tierney, and that damn dirty Tom Atlas, which again shows your what trusts you've been put in. You and Patrick have both got through FCW that you've been put in these positions, but all came to a head at Tayport with the FCW tag team titles. So this is just this past weekend as of recording, and there's a bit of heartbreak in Tayport. I was getting the little bit of the report from my sources that it looked like you won. You became a champion in Fair City Wrestling, and it was taken away by bloody officials.
I mean,
What was
what we
it like
call
as a moment though, holding that title and just being in front of people that you knew or at least had become au fait with through the things like Tayport State of Mind? What was it like holding that belt?
For a split second, it felt great. For that second, seeing the people cheer, the girl jumping off their seat, happy to see the titles off them as well, and on people that deserve it, I would say. You know, the true heroes of Tayport, some might say. Yeah, it felt great for that split second before they were viciously wiped back out of our hands by the ref. It was very hard. I didn't see the foot in the road in a lot of debate. So, but if that's the decision made, then that's fine. We were ready to go for that rematch, but Sebastian being Sebastian took advantage before the match officially restarted.
Just a bunch of assholes, aren't they?
Yeah, they are.
But it for you, for yourself, you've got that history with Patrick, and that's how it morphed into Not Safe for Mums. Just taking the bitter, not the bitterness, that's not the right phrase there, but taking the emotional side out of things. When you go look back and seeing how that faction grew from seemingly, like when you go back through the beats of them seemingly teaming up at other shows and then slowly becoming a stable and unit. That is pretty cool as a storyboard point for Fair City Wrestling. Like I say, you've got that emotional side to it where they maybe unjustly cost you a chance of being a champion in Fair City Wrestling, but it's quite amazing seeing how that all grew in. And the fact that they held the titles for a week and folk were already champing at the bit to see you guys dethrone
Get
them,
it off them. Yeah.
that's testament to how much of a bunch of bastards they are.
Yeah.
Fair say. So that's kind of up to date in the world of Kairn Douglas wrestling standpoint. Of course, there's bits and pieces here and there, but that's the main beat points of Kairn Douglas. So let's go to the wonderful questions because we have got
Oh,
loads.
yes,
So
let's. Oh,
we'll start with, do you want the ones that are quite good questions or do you want the weird questions first?
no, I think we'll do a good question first, and then we'll
Cool.
end with some weird ones.
That's fine. I've got Ryan Rude questions sitting in my inbox to go through. Patrick Potierski, who's had a few mentions, the Day of Birth Bonanza champion in 2024, for those that are unaware. Will you ever get tired of hitting Tommy Cross with a strap?
No, I don't think so. No.
He's got one of those faces, doesn't he? Just,
Yeah.
yeah, I suppose, I feel like
No,
it's just a not necessarily mean thing to
no,
say about him.
no. Like, yes, I would happily hit him with a strap daily if I could. Okay.
Second question, which tag team would you most like us to face?
Ooh, get a good few. I think Cristiano Brutal would be a good wee match up.
Oh, yeah.
I think that would be a good wee match up for us.
We're spoilt for choice now in Scotland with tag teams.
Yeah, we're doing good in the tag team division now. Bring the back.
Absolutely. And the third one is mind that time Shane McMahon blew his quad at WrestleMania.
I do. Snoop Dogg saved the day. Also, mind the time Vince McMahon blew his quads out as well.
We're,
Terrible
we've
quads.
we've escalated the name of naming of wrong people now.
Oh yes, I forgot. Forgot.
The Shane blowing his quad thing is like, I
We
think
want the chances.
I think my favorite thing about it though is like I thought they would cut it out, and then I watched it back thinking no, it didn't happen. I watched it back the next day, watched the replay, and it was still in it. And
Yeah.
I thought they would have taken that out. There was like,
I think because Snoop Dogg saved the day. I think that's why they kept it in.
oh, what a WrestleMania moment that was.
I know.
I feel like just it was Jessica Carr, the referee, just go do something, and then just
Do the
Snoop
people's
just.
elbow. Do the people's elbow.
It was the fact that just Snoop just turned around and punched The Miz, like
Snowboard
be
just punching them in the face.
the just to be The Miz in that scenario,
Yeah.
just going what the smack. Anyway, what a moment! What a WrestleMania moment! Hopefully replayed for years to come.
Yes.
Ian Ambrose asks. Well, that's a weird question. We'll go for a nicer question before we come back to
Okay.
that one. Oh, this is very difficult. That was the nicest. Okay, here we go. Connor Stibbles, he has asked, Who would you say your biggest inspiration growing up is?
As in, like, wrestler or just
Just life, why not?
biggest inspiration? I don't know. I mean, that's a hard one. I don't know. I don't know, actually. I've never really been one to think of someone in that retrospect. And I feel like an arsehole for not having something for that question.
You don't have a mantra, you don't wake up every day and go, "What would Chris Benoit do?" You know, that kind of thing.
I definitely don't have, I definitely don't have that.
There's your merch. terrible thing he did.
Oh,
Let's
this is the official name of my notebook. What would Christine want to do? Oh,
Oh, this may be the episode. You know, it's almost 300 episodes. Why not get cancelled before that one?
yeah.
Let's do it. All right. Yeah. So yeah, maybe in wrestling now. We'll narrow the field.
Oh. I mean, it would probably be the two. One that I remember watching from the Kurt Angle, from watching as a wee guy, and Daniel Bryan from Forget Me In. Very similar styles as well, like being very technical wrestlers. So yeah, they two would probably, if it was wrestling inspiration, they would be my top two.
Can't believe I said what would Chris Benoit do on this podcast, and I'm not going to take it out either. And it's I'm just going to like be really scared when this episode goes out.
Yeah,
Sean
goodbye,
McCulloch.
future career. Yeah,
Ah, it's all right. It's fine.
I
What career? Sean McCulloch asks, who would you rather have back you up in a fight, Patrick Peterski or a Trebuchet?
Peterski, because he's as powerful as a trebuchet and more.
I am. Definitely not googling trebuchet. I thought that was a type of cheese. Oh, okay. That's not a type of cheese at all. That is a catapult.
What? What cheese sounds like trebuchet?
Don't know. Maybe it's just because I'm fat and just really like cheese. this is for anyone who's listening and has listened to past episodes. We're past 9 o'clock, and that's when things start going weird. I don't know why. I have a 2-year-old. I don't sleep a lot. So he's also asked, Sean, you're dancing not. Oh no, that was just the follow up to the same question. You're dancing not safe for mum's partner or the ability to crush your enemy's fortifications. Oh, wonderful word, fortifications.
Yeah, but pretty sure, as I stated earlier, my tag team partner would be able to do that anyway.
There you go. So
So, easy answer.
that's more nice questions. Let's see.
Well, they're the nice ones.
These are the nice ones. Neil Malone, we're just going to go to the weird ones before I go to Instagram. Neil Malone, have you ever kissed Lane Lynette, a name I can't even say. Have you ever kissed Lorraine Kelly, or do you have an NDA about that?
All I can say is I haven't.
There we go. We'll leave that open.
All I can say, right?
John Young. Your fearless leader, could Jesus microwave a burrito so hot that he himself could not eat it?
No.
I'm going to try and sing.
Unless it was like a hell version of a microwave, then I don't think so.
Andrew Condon asks, and I'm going to try and not sing it because just for everyone's ears. Can you take me higher to a place where blind man see? Affirmative, for those that may have missed that. Ian Ambrose, do you wipe sitting down, standing up, or just save time and go crusty?
Neither. I like to take inspiration from the French and spray a bit of water there.
Oh, bidet.
Yeah, is that what it's called?
Um,
You too, mate.
don't speak French, it's fine. We've got Sean Moran, you've mentioned. What bar is, sorry, I'll do this with the accent. Not Sean's accent. That'd be really
I
offensive.
thought you were going to do a Sean accent.
Know. I'm going to do a really bad Irish accent. It might turn into Sean for all I know. What
What?
bar is UNG Mackie?
What bar is UNG Mackie? What does that mean?
Oh, have you not watched OSW Review?
But no, I might have missed this one.
Oh, this is watch your SW review. You're gonna love it. But
Yes.
at the same time, there's three Irish guys. One of them, Steve V1, he compares wrestlers' attires to chocolate bars or ice creams or
Oh,
packets, things like
right.
that. So, I mean, Ewan's a very, very interesting
What so
combination.
it would be to its extreme, the apple kind.
There we go. I'm just gonna just look at
To
up,
its
even though
extreme,
I
the
know it.
apple kind.
Yeah, that's pretty spot on. Yeah, I like that you had that like right off the top of your head once you knew the concept of
But
the
yeah, as soon as I
mission.
knew the concept, I was like going through every just trying to find something with them colours.
We've got Filthy Ryan Rude coming up the rear with two que well one statement and one question. The first one just being miss you bro.
I miss you too, bro. Miss you too.
So
See you soon.
how awkward was it that Ryan Rude got attacked and seemingly died in the FCW universe, and then I had a podcast come out with them 2 days later where we talked about
Hello?
his upcoming match at wrestling that day. That was terrible timing. And he's also asked, and this is a question that is referenced to his episode. For those that are unaware, go back, check Ryan Rude's episode of the SWN podcast. What's the name of the chair in the corner of a room in a hotel?
The good old fashioned cup chair, as Ryan likes to call it.
Yes, the cuck chair. That's
Yes. He's far too aware of this chair, isn't he?
he was far too descriptive about the chair. That
Yeah.
was the kind of there was talk of bending over and stuff like that. I'm it's 9 o'clock
Was
at
also
night. Calm
saying
down.
like for someone to come watch, but I'm pretty sure he was meaning himself. But we don't know. We don't know.
Have you been invited to sit in the chair?
No, and I really don't want that. Thanks. That's a no from me.
Life flash before your eyes there for a moment, and other things flashing. So that was the I thought that was a nice question just to round off the question format. I'm trying to think, making sure that I haven't missed any in particular, but I think that's everyone. Apologies if I've missed your question. Shit happens. Sorry guys. Very
That's
bluntly,
life.
that's life. Maybe the next one. Maybe I mean having asked. Have you listened to past podcasts? I don't want to put you on the spot here. Do you know this question that Ian Skinner asks everyone? I'm going to ask it to you now then because of
Yeah.
that quietness.
I thought you were like
No, I'm going to ask it now then. Just for my own enjoyment and because I haven't asked it in a couple of weeks. Would
Okay.
you rather have unlimited bacon but no more games or games, unlimited games but no games?
Would they rather have? Sorry, say that again.
Would you rather have unlimited bacon but no more games, or games, unlimited games but no games?
Games, unlimited games, but no games. That makes no sense.
That's this question. That's just the question. Just got to. I'm gonna
It
let
doesn't
you.
feel like a question, though. It feels like a weird statement.
I feel like this is gonna be the one that after we end recording and we leave the Zoom room, you're gonna spend the rest of the evening going. What group chat? When can someone explain this to me?
Yeah.
And in the
It's
middle of
just
the
I think
night,
the Skinner up to his usual nonsense though, isn't it?
it's a question that appeared on Twitter, and he just gets me to ask everyone it. Generally, gets me to ask everyone it if he remembers to send the question in. And yeah, it's broken everyone so far. I think there's only one person maybe that has given it a legitimate answer, and I cannot remember who it is right off the top of my head. There we go. There's the
Yeah.
awkward portion, and we thought the crispy wild stuff would be it, but no, it's me asking
Oh, we're
this
bringing it
question.
back up. We're going right back to it again.
Oh no,
We're
I'm
not
just.
letting that. We're not letting this die. We're bringing it
We're
right back up.
to be honest, if they got this far and they got past the crispy wild chat, and they're still here, then that's more fool them at this point.
This going to be the first podcast with a disclaimer? Be aware, Chris Benoit talk.
I forgot. Again, we survived the Ryan Rude episode, and
Yes.
that was a list in handy
No, that
of
was a list.
things. Anyway, so looking forward, looking ahead, let's relax back into the world of Kairn Douglas wrestling instead of confusing you with weird questions. What's the next goal in mind then? Is it title aspirations? Is it working for a certain place? Where's your kind of head at for your journey?
Ideally, I would like to travel around a wee bit. I would like to maybe get across to back on the West Coast, maybe like Valor or APW, somewhere like that. Get or even down to Discovery, and I'd like to maybe get down to Newcastle with Ryan, see what we could get up to down there. So that's kind of my main goal, is just to kind of get about, experience the traveling, wrestling with different promotions, and build myself and my knowledge up as well. Getting my reps in. That's really what I'm looking forward for.
Am I right in thinking in that respect that there was a police officer that turned up at Community Pro that looked suspiciously like you, or is
No,
that no?
I
All right, okay, that's fine. We'll just
don't know
we'll move on from that.
about that. There may have been, but what do I don't recall that. I don't recall.
so that in mind, then you mentioned Discovery, you mentioned APW. I've mentioned Community Pro, and Valor seems to be like a, would be like a homecoming for you a little bit because of the Looking Sharp connection there. Who would you want to face? Whether it is, you mentioned tag teams, Casino Brutal, but who yourself as a singles, who would you want to get in the ring with? Who's on your like bucket list for the next 12 months?
That's a good one. I mean, do you know what I would like to? I would like to get in the ring with people I used to train me that are going really well with. So I'd like to get like Stone Malone, maybe even Euna Raw or The Wanderer. People that I've had good experience with in the past that I've not seen in a while. That's even Sean Moran. Let's get Sean Moran a wee doing. Sean Moran deserves a wee doing, does he not?
I saw him refereeing jeans up in Peterhead, so you know that's worth the doing if ever there was one. No, he's just come back, didn't he? He had a match at,
Yeah, he's pulled
was
his
that
way
like,
back up again. It's good to see. I'm chuffed for him.
we've had him. We haven't had, I don't think I've had him on the mainline podcast. I've had him on the Sharp Dojo series, and yeah, a guy that's just, he loves wrestling, and I'm glad that he's found a way back. Back into it as well. So okay, so that's a good kind of way to go. And there's a lot of people that you could conceivably see in Fair City at the same time. I think Stone Malone would be cracking, and I don't know if he's had a match in Fair City before, but I bet Stone Malone would be absolutely cracking
Yeah, I think
in
so as
Perth.
well.
And a lot of those kind of guys. So that's your 12 months, guys, that you want to possibly get in the ring with. Beyond then, what's the goal? What's the end game? Have you got AEW aspirations? Have you got Japan? What's your kind of, what's the
I'm
budget?
just kind of going with the punches. Pun not really intended, but I'm happy to see where it takes me and what opportunities arise. I'm not as young as some other people in the game. So I'm just happy to see where I can get and what, as I said, what opportunities arise. Take whatever comes my way.
Absolutely fair enough. So I think we've covered just about everything. Is there anything that you think that you thought I might bring up that I haven't, that's popped into your brain, or we've kind of a nice little compassing all in. Were you part of the rabble with Hunter Redwood, if I remember rightly, where you
Where he was
accosted
kidding.
Matthew
Oh my God,
back?
I had to like try and talk me down. But you had to like, you let him go. And then I bumped into Simon Miller as well. I saw Simon Miller whilst when we lost Hunter, so we were trying to find him, and I somehow bumped into Simon Miller instead of finding Hunter.
Did you tell him you had a podcast?
I don't think I was on the podcast at that time, actually,
Ah,
was
damn. Oh no, that would have been right. Damn.
I?
Opportunities there. You could Simon Miller on the FCW podcast. One
Oh,
day.
maybe.
One day.
Monday.
Once
That would be Simon Miller would be a good opponent, by the way, at some point. That would be.
he's come up here now. He's done CPW, so he's got a little bit of the Scottish experience, so possibly we'll.
Did he do Discovery as well?
I did. Yes, he did.
Yeah, yeah.
I was
Yeah,
about to say what match he was in. I don't think I can.
was it Skinner? Is Skinner not wrestling?
That was Sov Pro. I don't know if it was
Or
Discovery.
was that?
He was in a six man in. He was definitely in a six man in Discovery, and I think it was him. I want to say Sean McLaughlin. and somebody else. You know what? I have the access to the internet. Why can't I just go check? Yeah.
Google is our friend in
Let's
2024.
do it. You know what? You know, podcast some podcasters would maybe take this out, but no, here I am, just gonna Google it. Cage match. Scotland. It was Simon Miller and the 9-9. Dickie Divers and Jack Morris taking on Pure Dead Brilliant with Luke King Sharp, Krieger and Redacted. So I got a couple of matches in CBW, so there we go. We've got Ada. Hang on. It's an FCW staple. Commissioner, book it. Book it, Commissioner. I've got to say it. Book it, Commissioner. Anyway, right. So with that being said, we've possibly got ourselves cancelled, and I apologise for that. With the old chat about that rabid Wolverine. Do you think that name should come back? No, I'm on another subject. No, it should have done. Should have came back when Tom had the sideburns and the long hair. Should have been called Rabid Wolverine, but then he cut it.
I don't know why I cut it. I should have kept it.
I know. I compared it to a character from Jekyll and Hyde, specifically David Hasselhoff from the stage version. And I was really chuffed myself when I wrote that. And I was like, ha, that's the day done. I'll put down my keyboard.
I can rest.
I can rest. Nothing's topping that today. I'll come back and do the other matches later. We are wildly going off topic. I've like I say, it's past 9 o'clock. I'm tired. I've got dad brain on just all over the place. So we're gonna wrap up here. Where can people find out more about Kairn Douglas and Not Safe for Mums and anything else you want to plug?
You can let me get back. I'm on Facebook and I'm sure it's just under Kairn Douglas. And I'm on Instagram. What is my handle on Instagram? Let me just find it's Kairn Douglas as well. And then you can also find if on YouTube NSFM where we are going to start posting some of our promos and some wee videos and that we put together and try and get them out as well for people's entertainment. So you give them a wee like. Hopefully you'll get some more. I've just had a wee brain fart and forgot what I was saying.
Go follow, Not Safe for Mums.
Content, that was the one. You'll get more content from this. That's it.
That's it. You can do more challenges and just do all the TikTok stuff. Do all the dances. That's the way to go forward. Anyway. So thank you for joining me. Thank you for
No,
everyone
thank you for
listening.
having us.
We will wrap up here and then have a chat after the thing where we go, why did we say that? Why did I say that? Why did I keep bringing it back up? But in the meantime, this has been Kairn Douglas. This has been an
Yes, thank
absolute
you.
fascinating, slightly derailed chat, but I can only apologize for what I've said about it. Please don't cancel me. I'm so close to 300 episodes. In the meantime, thank you. And yeah,
No,
thanks for coming
thank
on.
you for having me. I might go watch some Pegasus Kids stuff later on. I think that's what I'll go do.
Some Dynamite Kid, some.
Oh.